strike my gavel. Good morning, and welcome to today's meeting of the Commonwealth Club, the place where you're in the know. And thank you for attending both this panel discussion and the upcoming speech. Our topic today is really one that affects every American, whether they know it or not. U.S. transportation infrastructure, buying the future, or maybe we should say paying for the future, because we're going to pay for it one way or another, the old pay me now or pay me later with respect to infrastructure. If you've ever been stuck in traffic on the Bay Bridge, if you've been late to meetings, if you had your weekend ruined because you couldn't get to where you were headed, you know that California, like most places in this country, suffers from a major transportation infrastructure problem. Whether it's growing number of potholes, whether it's, and you haven't had it here, but bridges collapsing, we've seen them other places. Thousands of commuters and other travelers and our movement of goods are being affected every day because we have an inadequate, a faltering transportation infrastructure system. It hasn't kept up with our needs, and we haven't kept up with the needs of the system in terms of reinvesting to keep it in good shape. So at today's Transportation Infrastructure Summit, our panel of experts, and they are indeed experts, are going to examine what we can do, what we must do to solve these issues. Our panel represents viewpoints from the national and state level. We're going to talk about potential revenue options. I think one of our people who is not in political office is going to be able to do that. We discover most people in political office are deathly afraid of talking about that subject. And we'll talk about what the likely reception is to these ideas from citizens and legislators. Our panelists today, and I'll introduce each of them now, and then we'll hear from them, Dr. Asha Weinstein Agrawal. Asha is the director of the Moneta Transportation Institute's National Transportation Finance Center, as well as an associate professor in urban and regional planning at San Jose State. She's worked in transportation finance for more than a decade, and interested in other things as well, transportation planning and policy, planning for pedestrians and cyclists, an important issue as we develop that part of our transport system, and transportation history. I have not been around for all of transportation's history, but right after the wheel was invented, I came around. We'll talk about that. Steve Heminger is executive director of the Metropolitan Transportation Commission, which those of you in this region know of as your regional transportation planning and finance agency for the entire Bay Area, corralling all of those transit operators and other providers of transportation to do it in a consistent way. Steve serves as vice chair of the policy committee of the Association of Metropolitan Planning Organizations and as chair of a special Transportation Research Board Committee on Congestion Pricing, as well as having served on the National Policy Commission that was created after the passage of the last surface reauthorization bill to give us direction to what to do on the next one. We'll ask you how you doing that? How's that coming?
If only we had done it.
Steve received a Master of Arts from University of Chicago, and his BA is from Georgetown. Mike Scanlon is general manager and CEO of the San Mateo County Transit District and the executive director of Caltrain. Previously, he was at the Port Authority of Allegheny County in Pittsburgh, where he oversaw all of the transit operations in that key city for 26 years and served for 6 years as the CEO of Broward County Transit in Fort Lauderdale, Florida. Mike has been very active in the American Public Transportation Association and is currently the chair of that national trade group and leading us all in the transit world. Scanlon attended University of Pittsburgh, and he resides here in Redwood City. John Horsley is the executive director of the American Association of State Highway and Transportation Officials, better known as ASHTO, a post that he's held since 1999. That association advocates policy but also provides leadership on behalf of the states as they improve all of the transportation systems in their jurisdictions. Prior to moving to ASHTO, John was nominated by President Clinton and confirmed by the Senate as the Associate Deputy Secretary of Transportation, was my associate, John Horsley. He served in that position and in the department from 1993 to 1999, advocating for intermodal policies, for quality of life initiatives, and serving as DOT's liaison to all other branches of government. As a native of the Northwest, Mr. Horsley was elected to 5 terms as county commissioner in Kitsap County in Washington. That's west of Seattle. If you didn't know, there are things west of Seattle besides the Pacific Ocean. John had everything between Seattle and the ocean. So let's welcome our panelists. And we'll start. I'm going to ask each of you in turn to provide your perspective on the issues we're facing. Where are we going to find the revenues? What are the consequences if we don't find the revenues? How do we deal with our future transportation needs? And let me remind the audience, with respect to the questions, anytime you think of a good question, get it down on paper, get it up here. I will ask them, but if you want them directed to a particular individual on the panel, be sure you do that. Otherwise, I'll pick. And I'll turn it first to Asha.
I'd like to thank the Commonwealth Club and today's event organizers very much for inviting me to get to be the person on the panel who's sort of under no obligation to anyone. I'm not appointed. I'm not elected. I get to say exactly what I think. And what I'd like to do today is maybe try and challenge a little bit some of the sort of conventional political wisdom about taxes for transportation. Right now, I think if you read many articles, or really almost any newspaper article about, you know, could we raise the gas tax, somebody will be quoted, somebody important, as saying, oh, no, Americans hate the gas tax, and they would just absolutely not accept any increase in taxes right now. But is that true? Now, obviously, the truth is tricky to pin down, especially when you have something as amorphous as public opinion. But I would like to suggest that the picture is really not quite as bleak as conventional wisdom might have it, and that perhaps what we really have is more a problem of politicians being unwilling to raise things like the gas tax rather than the public actually being opposed to that option. And today, to try and give you some evidence of why I've come to that conclusion, I'm really excited to be able to share the results of a new public opinion poll that asks the public, a national sample, about their support or opposition to a variety of different federal-level transportation taxes and fees. And just to give credit where credit is due, I should mention that the project was funded by the Mineta Transportation Institute, and also that my co-author on the project is with us here today, Professor Hillary Nixon. Anyway, this poll is the second in what we are hoping will be a long and useful series, an annual series, so that we'll be able to track how public feelings about different tax options might change over time, or not, as the case may be. So this is the second year. Last year, actually, I've had the privilege of sharing the results here also. And what we did was we actually had 11 different taxes that we asked about. 8 were different variations on a gas tax increase. There were 2 variations on a mileage tax. That would be a brand new tax for us. And also, sort of for comparative purposes, 1 hypothetical national sales tax. Before actually sharing the results, though, I will keep you on the edge of your seats and quickly say I want to just share what we know about public opinion about gas and mileage taxes from other polling efforts over the years. So with gas taxes, we looked at 26 different surveys, public opinion polls, from the last 6 years or so. And most of these are asking about state or federal level tax increases. And the support levels really just vary wildly. Truly all over the map. I think we found a low of 15% support in one case, all the way up to 77% support in another. But there are 2 trends that I think stand out fairly clearly amongst this chaos. One is that the support is usually, well, not so high. One could say kind of low. It tends to be under 50%. But on a maybe more optimistic note, there was a trend that most of the polls which found higher levels of support somehow linked a gas tax increase to environmental benefits. And that was done in a variety of different ways. But that seems to be a pretty clear trend. So that's maybe the big picture on gas taxes and polling. With mileage taxes, since we don't actually have a mileage tax and there's never been a real proposal in the U.S. to have one, not so much polling has been done. But of the six examples we found, pretty clear picture, not popular. Support tends to be even under 30%, so fairly different from the gas tax in that sense. So getting back though to our own survey, this was a national random digit dial phone survey, and we talked to 1,519 people. And this was one of these annoying things where someone calls you at dinner time and interrupts you. That's the kind of thing we were doing. And we were able to interview people in English or Spanish. And we also were very pleased to have both landlines and cell phones, since nowadays, as you may know, there are lots of households which no longer have a landline. And we tested 11 tax options. As I mentioned, 8 of these were variations on the idea of a gas tax increase. 2 were variations on a mileage tax, and then there was a sales tax. I should stress that what we weren't trying to do with this poll was assess, you know, if we put a specific proposal on the ballot, say, would it pass or not? Because as we all know, any specific ballot measure, the support is going to depend enormously on the context, what else is on the ballot that year, you know, what are the local political considerations, et cetera. So our results shouldn't be used that way. But what I think our poll can do really well is to help us understand how the public, the relative support, how support changes among different tax options. So for example, you know, how might people feel about a gas tax versus a mileage tax? Or if you have different variations on a gas tax option, which are likely to be more supported than others. So let me start first with the results. When we just asked about what I'm calling our base case gas tax and mileage tax options, these were sort of the plainest, least interesting, least details given. We basically just said, what if we pass this new tax and use the revenue for transportation? So pretty general. With the gas tax, what we asked people about was increasing the existing federal gas tax of 18 cents by 10 cents a gallon. And, well, support was not too high. We actually only got 24% of people saying that they would support such a tax increase. And then we also asked them about our sort of base case mileage tax, and there we told people that it would be a tax of 1 penny a mile for every mile driven. And this was actually even more unpopular, although not too much. We only got 22% of people saying that they would support that option. But that's not the end of the story. I actually think there is some much more positive news to be gained from this survey. What we discovered was that every single variant we asked on these two base case taxes got higher support. In some cases, I would say quite dramatically higher support. So let me give you some examples. With the mileage tax, we, as I said, had initially asked people about the base case, which was just 1 cent a mile for everybody. We then followed up and said, well, what if everybody paid an average of a penny a mile, but the specific rate charged is linked to your vehicle type, and more polluting vehicles would pay a higher rate, and less polluting vehicles would pay a lower rate? We found that support actually went up 14 percentage points, so from 22% for the base case to 36% for this variable rate option. Again, it's still not a popular tax in this survey, but there's a very noticeable bump in support when you put that environmental spin on it. And so that, I think, is the really key lesson to take away. Now, with the gas tax, we saw similar increases in support, again, when we started giving people more details. So, for example, one thing we said was, well, what if instead of that 10 cent increase per gallon, 10 cent per gallon increase at one time, we increased 2 cents a year for 5 years? Well, here we have support go up. Actually, it went up in this case 15 percentage points, from 24% to 39%. Now, another thing we asked about was, well, what if we did a one-time 10 cent a gallon gas tax increase, but instead of that amorphous transportation purposes, we dedicated the revenue to be spent on projects that would reduce the transportation system's contribution to global warming. we got a 21% increase, a 21 percentage point increase in support. So here we got 45% support for that option on a gas tax. And then just to give you one last example, when we said, okay, well, what if we had that 10-cent one-time gas tax increase, but this time we dedicated the revenues to maintaining streets, roads, and highways. And here we actually saw a 38 percentage point increase. So we got a total of 62% of people, you know, fairly close to two-thirds, saying that they would support such a gas tax increase. So again, I think that what this is really showing is it really matters what kind of tax. The public does not see all taxes as identical and therefore does not, you know, oppose them all at identical levels. So we really have to be very careful about what kinds of taxes we think about and try and craft something that, matches with public priorities and, of course, at the same time also meets what we as sort of transportation professionals think are important priorities for our transportation system. Now, I should also just go back to the fact that this is the second year of what we're hoping is going to be a long and fruitful trend of annual polls, and we don't have too much to compare at this point, just 2 years, two data points, but we did look at that, of course, and there's a very simple message. Almost nothing has changed. Support levels were actually almost identical, certainly within the margin of error of the polls, for virtually all of the taxes from last year and this, which I think tells us two things. One, you know, obviously the economy is changing a bit, events are changing a bit, but public opinion seems to be fairly stable on these issues. But also I think that it adds some credibility to the results. Even though a poll of 1,500 people should give you pretty sound representative results, you always could have something very strange happen and you got an odd sample of people who held very unusual views. But if we're getting the same results more or less 2 years in a row, I think it's pretty clear that we didn't have that bad luck and get sort of odd and unrepresentative results. And we look forward over coming years to see if these results continue to hold or if there is some change in public views on these topics. Now, I also wanted to say that in addition to just looking at how the overall population supports or doesn't these transportation taxes, we were also interested to look at different subgroups within the population. You know, are there certain small groups that are really supportive, others that really oppose? And so we broke people up into all kinds of groups. We looked at men versus women, for example, and other sociodemographic groupings. We looked at a few political characteristics, just a couple of travel behavior characteristics, and also some perceptions that people hold about the transportation system and their priorities for improving it. And we actually found relatively few clear sort of divisions within the population. I mean, there and I will mention the few that we did find. But just to give you an example, we actually found no clear pattern for support that linked support for the taxes with income. You know, you might think people who have less income would be less supportive, but we did not find that. And the same for a lot of the other things like, gender, for example, where you might expect to find something. However, there were a few cases where actually for both years, 2010 and 2011, we found, you know, a particular group was extra supportive as compared to the other subgroups in that same range. So, for example, when we did look at race, we found that Asian Americans and African Americans tended to be more supportive than people who self-identified themselves as white. We also found that younger people tended to be more supportive than older people. We found that those respondents to our poll who we would characterize as unlikely voters were more supportive than people who might be likely voters. We also found that people who had used transit in the last 30 days were more likely to support the taxes. And finally, also that people who place a high priority on expanding and improving local public transit service were more likely to support these taxes than people who didn't put a priority on that. Finally, politics, you might have been wondering. Actually, we did find in both surveys that Democrats were more supportive than Republicans. But one actually interesting change from year to year is last year those results weren't actually so the distinction was not so stark. This year there was a much bigger divide between Republicans and Democrats on these topics. So it may be that, you know, as we see our political leaders kind of hardening yet more into their political positions, possibly the public is following a little bit there. Although I should follow up and add that this does not mean that, you know, we had wild differences between Democrats and Republicans, just that there was some distinction. And then also I should point out sort of that in these subgroups, we looked for all of these subgroups to see, to compare with the base case, like just the plain Jane 10-cent gas tax increase, you know, for all these little subgroups, did their support increase for the different variants on the base case taxes? And we found virtually in every case, yes. So we had something like 450 little population subgroups, you know, because we had eight taxes and a bunch of different population groups. And across those 450 or so cases we looked at, in only four cases was there not an increase in support for one of these variants as opposed to the base tax. So that includes, of course, also Republicans and older people and all these little subcategories who are maybe not as supportive of the taxes in general. So even for those groups, these variations increased support. So let me just wrap up here by trying to suggest what I think are, you know, what are some of the policy implications that we can take away from this work. And I think there are two very encouraging lessons. One is that whether or not, you know, in general, the public is supportive of gas taxes or mileage taxes, we can definitely improve support levels if we're really careful about how we craft those taxes, how we design them, and also how we explain them to people. So there's a fair amount that's sort of within our control, I think, as a policy community. And then secondly, that I think that one option for improving public support for transportation taxes is to link those with some kind of environmental benefits. I'm not at all saying this is the only way, but I think that there's a pretty clear pattern that that is a way to increase support. And, you know, it is, I think, useful in meeting many of our other public policy objectives, whether it's, you know, improving local air pollution, reducing global warming, or the other environmental challenges that we face. And here in California, I think we're particularly aware of. So with that, I thank you for your attention and look forward to the other panelists.
Thank you, Asha. That's a lot for us to think about as we grapple with a very tough issue. Steve Heminger from MTC, please give us your thoughts. And I gather you have a presentation.
I do. So the good news is I have a little visual entertainment for you. You don't have to look at me as I speak. And I'm going to take a quick tour around some transportation issues, beginning here in the San Francisco Bay Area and working my way through Sacramento back to Washington. You know, Charles Dickens began one of his novels, "It was the best of times, it was the worst of times," and I feel a little bit like that with respect to infrastructure, because we are obviously living through a very difficult time economically, and paradoxically, we've got more construction activity going on in the Bay Area than we've probably had in decades. The Bay Area economy is experiencing a stronger economy, stronger recovery than most of California, but our state is still lagging behind the rest of the nation. We are in positive figures, though, again, which is the good news. After a couple of really horrible years, we do see sales tax growth in our region for 2 years running. That's especially important for our public transit systems, which rely very heavily on that revenue source here in California. I have to say, though, that the cloud in front of that silver lining is the fact that our long-term job forecasts in the region prepared by the Association of Bay Area Governments are, every time they do one, the number goes down. And I've almost thought that I should just ask them to stop doing them. Maybe that will make the problem better. But I think what they are realizing, as you can see as these colored lines head down this chart, they obviously are taking account of the fact that this recession is prolonged and severe, but you can also see that the slope of the line is reduced. The Bay Area post-war was growing jobs at a rate of about 4% a year. That was through 1990. Since 1990, we've been growing jobs at less than 0.5% per year on average. And the real troubling question for us is whether that is what our future is going to look like instead of the 1950s. Despite that, we've got an incredible amount of work going on. We are getting very good bids, which is also a good news, bad news story. The good news is the taxpayers are saving money, and their money is going farther. The bad news is I sense that a number of these construction firms are bidding either at or below cost just to get the work, just to keep their folks, and that's not something they can do for a very long time. A couple of pictures of particular projects that we are building, probably the most notable one, and we believe the largest public works project in America right now, is the $6 billion replacement of the eastern half of the San Francisco-Oakland Bay Bridge. This is a bridge that was built during the Great Depression, and we're now replacing half of it during the Great Recession. You can see from the picture that we're almost done after it seems like 400 years, and we've got 2 years of work to go. You can see the major gaps connecting the steel portion of the bridge at deep water with the skyway, which is the concrete structures that stretch over to Oakland in the picture. That skyway is the longest fishing pier in the region right now. It's not doing a whole lot of good besides. And you can also see a lot of work going on at the island where we need to connect the new bridge into the tunnel. The tower is probably the most notable feature of this new structure. It now stands over 500 feet tall, so it's as tall as the towers on the west spans. You can see this tower from just about anywhere in the region now, including from downtown San Francisco, which is what we intended. And soon this tower will top out. If those of you who do travel that corridor, you've seen one of the catwalks go up on the backspan. And so once all the catwalks are up, this will start to look like a fairly traditional suspension bridge with the cable spinning beginning later in the fall. We've also got a big old transit terminal underway in downtown San Francisco. We're calling it Grand Central Station West that will open in 2017. All told, it's a $4 billion project. The piece of it under construction now is a little north of $1 billion, and that will handle the bus capacity that we need. But we're also building a $400 million hole in the basement for high-speed and conventional speed trains. And so we are betting on that system being built and getting Caltrain downtown as we have been planning here in the Bay Area for, I think, 95 years. Here's another one. The parallels, I think, are really startling between the Depression and the Great Recession, because the Caldecott Tunnel was another Depression-era project. They built two of them at the time. We added a third somewhat later. We should have added a fourth at the time, but we didn't have the money. So now we're adding the fourth now so that there could be four lanes of traffic in each direction through the East Bay Hills. And this is another project underway. I think one of the largest single expenditures of the federal stimulus funds anywhere in the United States. And we certainly thank Uncle Sam for that. We're not just building new stuff, though. We have a lot of rehabilitation to do in our region, and one of the biggest jobs is to replace every single BART car that runs on that system now. You may recall several years ago, BART rehabilitated those cars, basically stripped them down to the shell. That rehabilitation now has reached the end of its useful age, and we've got to come up with about $3 billion to replace them all. We've got $1 billion underway, and BART will be awarding that contract sometime soon. One reason we've been able to put this much work out to bid and under construction is that we have a lot of local money, especially bridge tolls, that we've been able to use. While state and federal funding perhaps has been disrupted from time to time, we've been able to use those funds. I'll mention just one of the most creative things we did. when the state wasn't selling bonds because the market was so bad they were having to pay 7 or 8% interest, we went to the state and said, we'll buy some of your bonds. And we bought them privately. We just did a deal. And we paid them, they had to pay us a little bit less than 7 or 8% interest, which meant we were still making more than 0.5%, which is what we're making on our money right now. And we were able, in the bargain, to tell the state where we wanted the money to be spent. And guess what? We told them to spend it here on a series of projects that had been stalled in the Bay Area. That's just one example of, I think, the kind of intergovernmental creativity that we need to see more of. I'm going to give you one slide on the state because that's all they deserve. The news up in Sacramento is so bad, it's not even worth dwelling on. We're to the point now where the governor has vetoed a budget for, I think, the first time in memory. The legislators aren't getting paid. I think we are really now finally going through the wrenching, very difficult work of adopting a budget that we can afford. We have been for 10 years not doing that. We have a constitution like most states that says you have to adopt a balanced budget, and I think it's about time we do it and get it over with one way or the other. So let's turn to Washington, where the news is better, but not by a whole lot, because the Congress is in the middle of the same kind of debate that our legislature is over how to live within our means, and I think very importantly, as Asha raised, what our means ought to be, which is, I think, too often left out of that debate. And in the middle of that, we have a federal transportation bill that has expired, that is now on its seventh extension. And I think very importantly, those extensions have not extended the tax itself. And the federal gas tax expires by operation of law on September 30th of this year. That means Congress has to extend it by an act of Congress. And I'm just a little bit nervous that all the brinksmanship we've got going with the debt ceiling might just be repeated when we get to this one. There's our president, and I'll tell you, he has talked more about transportation than just about any president I can remember. And I think I agree with just about everything he said, except maybe the one about high-speed rail being 20 minutes from everybody's doorstep. but like a lot of folks, yeah, Rod Dyrdek would like that, though. That's his goal. But I have to say, the time for talk is over, and I think what we have seen from all of our leaders in Washington is a lot of talk and not enough action. And the kind of action we need, as Mort mentioned in the introduction, is very significant. Huge backlogs just to take care of the system we've already built. You know, the interstate in most places is 30, 40, some places 50 years old. Major repair bill. Our transit systems, the Metro in Washington, BART, they're 40, 50 years old. The Muni here in San Francisco is almost 100 years old. We just have a huge challenge to take care of the legacy that we've been given, and in my mind, that is job one. Here in the Bay Area, if you just look at the chart, look to the lower right, grand total, just one region in the United States, local roads, transit infrastructure, state highways, a $40 billion shortfall. That's not building a stick of new capacity. That is just taking care of the system we've built. That's the shortfall. We've got a lot of work to do. We have advocated that one thing that the Congress and the administration ought to be considering very seriously as they figure out how to renew our federal program is to focus more on what we call metropolitan mobility. The nation's metropolitan areas, the chart I'm giving you here, it's a little bit difficult to read. I would encourage you to go to the Brookings Institution website because they've got some very good and deep data on how important the nation's metropolitan areas are to our economy. Just as an example, the New York Times just a few weeks ago had an article about Montana and how about half the people in Montana live in three cities. Everybody is metro now. This is not just a coastal phenomenon. It's not just a blue state phenomenon. What we're talking about is a metropolitan nation. That's where the problems are, where 90%+ of the transit ridership is, the traffic congestion, the exposure to criteria pollutants. That's where the problems are. That's where we ought to be putting much more of our financial resources and attention. We, in fact, think there ought to be in the next authorization a Metro Mobility program that focuses specifically on those issues, that sets goals and targets for metropolitan areas to reach in reducing those problems and holds them accountable if they do not. And one thing I have to plea for as a Californian is that it would be nice if Washington rewarded us for self-help. This information is from a report that's about to be released by our State Transportation Commission showing that of all the money we're going to be spending in California over the next 10 years, 13% of it is federal. Now, we don't want to kick that 13% out of the room. It's not like we don't value it and need it. But a friend of mine in San Diego often says that the feds give us 20% of the money and 80% of the rules. And I think it would be nice to sort of right-size that. And I think it would also be nice to reward states that are doing so much themselves and to encourage others by rewarding those states to do more of the same. I think in an era of constrained resources, and that's clearly what we're living in, the big word is leverage. And I think the federal program could do much more, far more, to leverage the activities of state and local government as well as the private sector to get more work underway. I'm going to finish with the subject that Asha talked about, which is really where I think we're stymied. Not the only place we're stymied, because I think one reason we haven't moved a bill in Washington is no one quite knows what the federal program's supposed to do. And I think figuring that out actually is the primary task. But once we figure it out, how are we going to pay for it is another. And it is certainly the case that even if the public doesn't mind gas taxes, politicians certainly do. And there has been bipartisan agreement, administration and Congress, that they don't want to raise the gas tax. So here's an idea. Why don't they replace the federal gas tax with a sales tax on gas instead? Do it on a revenue-neutral basis in the first year, and then watch the price of gasoline rise, which it is going to do over time, as sure as I'm sitting here. I think that solution, which if you were to do it today, if you used an average price per gallon of $3.60, that would be about a 5% sales tax on gasoline. Another advantage of it is 5 is lower than 360. It looks like it's a reduction. The solution, I think, meets three critical tests at the outset. The first, it doesn't raise taxes. You can say it with a straight face. It might generate more income over time, but it doesn't raise the rate when you impose it. Secondly, it doesn't worsen the federal deficit. And I think one thing I hope we all agree about is we got to stop siphoning general fund money into the trust fund. And third, it can close the gap substantially on the infrastructure shortfall that I've shown you. This chart, which I'll conclude on, gives you a sense in black, or rather, let me talk about the red. That's the problem first. The red is the highway trust fund shortfall. If we were to try to keep funding levels at a reasonable level growing over the next few years, this is not what the trust fund can support. This is the shortfall that the trust fund cannot support to try to maintain those growing levels. It's something Senator Boxer's talked about as an objective in her legislation. How do you cover those shortfalls? If you did what I just suggested and converted the tax in year one on a revenue-neutral basis to a sales tax, and then the price of gasoline turned out to be what the Department of Energy is projecting over the next few years, look what happens. The shortfall is covered by the increased revenue. Now, look, that's not enough. These shortfalls are just to maintain sort of so-called baseline spending, and we need to be spending a lot more with baseline. But remember, the first rule of holes is when you're in one, stop the digging. And this is a way to stop the digging, because what happens with the gas tax now is everybody gets a tax cut every year as fuel efficiency improves. And guess what? No politician even gets credit for it. It's the worst kind of tax cut in the world. So what we need is a tax that will at least hold its own against the forces that are arrayed against it, whether it's fuel economy or inflation or whatever the case might be. That, to me, would be a wonderful step forward, and I will leave you with that thought to ponder as I conclude. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Steve. And let's turn now to Mike Scanlon.
Well, good morning, everybody. It's certainly my pleasure to be here. Perhaps for you, not so much. Many of you were coming expecting to see Bill Millar, and Bill Millar does send his regards and his regrets. It seems that Chairman Micah had asked that he be around to attend some meetings over some things, Bill, Steve, you just talked about, so we'll see where all that goes. There may be some slight repetition in particularly what Steve said and a little bit of what Asha said, but I think it's important that we keep drilling home that the needs are great in this nation right now. The critical need for investment in public transportation is very, very well documented. The capital assets earned a D, as in David, rating in the infrastructure report card developed by the American Society of Civil Engineers. John, this is the only line I'll steal from you, but according to AASHTO, more than $60 billion per year should be invested just in public transit capital. And the Federal Transit Administration found that an investment of $78 billion would be required just to bring our nation's rail and bus systems into a state of good repair. An additional $14.4 billion would be needed every year to simply maintain transportation infrastructure. So to be able to continue to meet the individual mobility needs, advance important national goals, and protect the federal investments that have already been made in the nation's public transportation infrastructure, Congress simply must pass a robust multi-year transportation bill and do it soon. Transit systems today have many, many critical challenges. They all are making very, very tough decisions. They're raising fares, cutting operations to cover their expenses, laying off the workforce. We've seen firsthand now how this great recession has affected funding, particularly at the local and state levels. APTA recently conducted a survey of its members to see what the impact of the economic downturn is having on our industry, and I want to share just some of those results with you. First, 90% of public transit agencies have reported flat or decreased local funding, and the same number have reported flat or decreased state funding. Budgetary pressures are increasing, with 7 out of 10 agencies projecting budget shortfalls in the coming year. And I would say this study is almost a little stale now because it's been about a year since we did the outreach. So we could probably, I think it's exacerbated since then. I don't have any science to share with you, but it's gotten worse, not better. Despite actions taken to address budgetary issues, 11 transit agencies project shortfalls in excess of 20% of their annual operating budgets, and the cumulative projected shortfall among participating transit agencies is approaching $2 billion. More than 8 out of 10 transit agencies, or 84%, have cut their service and raised fares or are considering either or of those actions for the future, with nearly 3 in 5 transit agencies, or 59%, having already done so. The larger agencies, frankly, are more likely to have a decrease in local, regional, or state funding, or even in fare revenues. Among larger agencies, more than half have already increased their fares, and 2 in 3 have cut their service. Nearly all, 97%, have cut service or raised fares, or are considering doing so in the future. More than half of all transit agencies, 53%, have eliminated positions, and 1 in 3 have laid off employees. Among larger transit agencies, the cuts in staff have been more common, with 4 out of 5, or 80%, reducing positions, and more than half laying off their employees, talking about jobs. So clearly, transit systems are continuing to struggle. And it's from the front lines, I can tell you, it's real, and it is very, 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 very difficult. At the same time, Americans, ironically, want more transit. We know this because last year they took more than 10.2 billion trips on public transportation. That's 35 million trips each and every weekday. 35 million trips each weekday. APTA released recently its first quarter ridership for this year, and in the first quarter of 2011, Ridership increased by 1.6%. That's compared to the same period in fiscal in 2010. That's the largest increase in 2 years. Nationally, in the first quarter of 2011, 39 million more trips were taken on public transit than in the first quarter of 2010. That's 3 million more rides per week. And across the nation, citizens at the same time are voting for more transit or are expressing a willingness to possibly vote for more transit, as Asha said in her earlier remarks. People have been asked to vote in favor of tax increases for public transit recently are very, in an overwhelming way, saying yes. This past November, for example, actually when the Tea Party fever was peaking, we hope, pro-transit ballot initiatives, sorry for that political comment, I just lost control of myself. Pro-transit ballot initiatives won in 73% of the elections in such diverse states as Michigan, South Carolina, Texas, and Washington. The rate of passage of pro-transit ballot initiatives for the entire year of 2010 was 77%. And on May 3rd, just this last month, voters approved 6 transportation-related ballot measures in elections. 5 of the measures, all were in Michigan, were property tax renewals or increases, while the other in Stark County, Ohio, was a sales tax renewal. In Asha's study, 69% of Americans said they either somewhat support or strongly support using their tax dollars for creating, expanding, or improving transportation in their community. And as Asha pointed out just a few minutes ago, and if you can tie it to the environment, you get even a better boom for your buck. So clearly, Americans are realizing that there are many benefits in public transportation, and particularly that tied to the environment. I don't think we can afford to lose that. Every $1 billion invested in public transportation creates and supports approximately 36,000 jobs. Every dollar invested in public transportation results in an average return of $4. Public transit is a significant solution to America's energy and environmental challenges. Public transit use saves 4.2 billion gallons of gasoline every year. Riding public transportation on average saves individuals a little over $10,000 annually. That's according to APTA's Transit Savings Report, which you can actually visit online. And the future is truly bleak without public transportation. Steve's warning of the gas tax itself possibly going away is particularly frightening. Without public transportation, Americans will suffer severely. According to the Texas Transportation Institute congestion study, which looked at 439 U.S. urban areas, travelers would have suffered an additional 785 million hours of delay. Now, I don't even know how to get my arms around that figure. 785 million hours of delay, and in doing so would have consumed 640 million more gallons of fuel. Maybe one of our problems is when we roll these numbers up in there in such an aggregate that people can't really relate to what it does on an individual basis, something that food for thought possibly in the future. Had there been no public transportation services in these areas, congestion costs for 2009 would have risen by nearly $19 billion, from what is now estimated at $115 billion to $134 billion. Public transportation simply is what drives our economy. It creates jobs and takes people to their jobs. With all the turmoil in the oil-rich countries, particularly in the Mideast right now, and the ups and downs of gas prices, there is no better time to focus on the investment of public transit. New York Times columnist Tom Friedman repeatedly refers and uses writer Kurt Anderson's phrase, the grasshopper generation. I assume probably most of this audience has seen at least some of the articles, if not read in some, have not read Kurt Anderson's books, to describe the baby boomers, saying that we are actually feeding off the greatest generation. You know, what if our elected officials in the early part of the last century had said we couldn't afford to build the New York subway or the Golden Gate Bridge or the San Francisco Bay Bridge or the Caldecott Tunnel or the fill in the blanks? How about we couldn't afford to build the interstate highway system? where would our country be? I think in a pretty sorry state. And the greatest generation, I'm ashamed to be a baby boomer because of what we've done to this planet and continue to do. And I mean, I think it's time that we really need to answer the call. I particularly like Steve's reference to the sales tax on gasoline. When I was about 15 years old, I actually pumped gas for a living. And at that time, in 1956, Frank, I wasn't quite pumping gas in 1956, but not too long after, the gasoline tax went to 3 cents a gallon to build the interstate highway system. But that was on a base of 20 cents, 22 cents, so that took gas up to 24.9 or whatever we paid. So the greatest generation was willing to pay what amounted to a 15% sales tax, not even a good tip, really, you know, an average tip on a meal. If we took 15 cents, or if we took 15% of what gasoline costs at the margins today, you'd be in the 40 to 50 cent range just by simply doing that. And it's no more than you tip a waiter or a waitress. Actually, I think most of us probably tip a little more. I hope we do, because they're working people. I think, you know, Winston Churchill, to paraphrase Winston Churchill, he used to say, you can always count on the American people to do the right thing, but only after they've tried everything else. Unfortunately, Mr. Churchill was talking about the greatest generation. I think the question before the House is, what about this generation? What are we going to do? When are we going to step up to do it? You know, we simply can't afford not to do it. We've got a big hill to climb. We've got so many new members of Congress who simply aren't familiar. And there's members of Congress right now that didn't even know the federal government was in this business. You know, transit? Highways? You know, I mean, it's shocking. And maybe Polly will get into some of that in her remarks, but then maybe not. She is appointed by the never mind. Well, others of us will take that risk. I'm not insulting Polly, by the way, like you did. But public transportation, really, it is about mobility. It's about increasing travel choices for all Americans. And it's not just now. It's for generations of Americans who will follow us. What are they going to say about what we did? I mean, is someone going to sit in a slideshow and say these cowards wouldn't even reach into their pockets to do what needed to be done? So I think all of us have a calling. All of us have to assist and answer the bell to go out and enlighten our society, and hopefully working together we can do it. So thank you for listening. I appreciate it very much.
Thank you, Mike, and let me turn it over to John Horsley.
Well, Mort, it's great to be here in California. Great to join you and Asha and Steve and Mike on this distinguished panel. I don't know about the rest of you, but I'm getting more depressed than when I started this morning. What I wanted to do is start by describing what's going on here in the U.S. In comparison to what's going on elsewhere in the world, because I think it is instructive. 2 years ago, when the Congress convened to try to bail us out of the worst recession in years and pass the Economic Recovery Act, $48 billion was made available to help beef up spending in transit and highways. $48 billion. The Chinese that year put forth a economic stimulus program of their own in the range of $600 billion. The Chinese are playing catch-up. The great generation that you described, Mike, that built the interstate, built a lot of the subway and the other infrastructure that we've been feeding off of for the last 50 years, that was the era of America building the finest transportation network in the world. Well, the Chinese are playing catch-up. They are in the process of building a 53,000-mile interstate network, express highway network, that will be larger in scope than what we have in the U.S. We're 47, they'll be 53, and they'll complete that by 2020. They're well on their way to getting there. They're putting in place a 10,000-mile network of high-speed rail. Just about every city pair in China is going to be linked by high-speed rail. So the Chinese, in their metro areas, Steve, you mentioned metro areas, they're doing the same in light rail, heavy rail, commuter rail, bus systems. They're modernizing their system to compete and urban, you know, deal with the urbanizing population of the 21st century. In Europe, what you saw a few years ago is the Danes and the Swedes build a bridge connecting the lower part of Europe to Scandinavia. The Swiss are in the process of building the longest bridge in the world, or longest tunnel in the world, that'll connect truck traffic from Central Europe down to the Mediterranean. Whether it's the Spanish or the French or the Germans, everyone in Europe is building out a network of high-speed rail and taking a fresh look at how they're modernizing their highway systems, usually funded by tolls. So they're finding ways to capitalize the improvements, they're making the improvements, and the Europeans recognize that to compete with the Chinese, the Indians, the Brazilians and the Russians, the economic competitors of the future, Europe's going to have to modernize its system. So the emerging nations are building for the first time their network so they can emerge and compete. The Europeans are modernizing their system so they can compete with those competitors. And so then we come back to what are we doing here in the U.S.? And Steve served on a distinguished panel about 3 years ago, came up with some great recommendations, and they concluded to meet America's needs for the future, to provide mobility for the American people and keep us competitive, we've got to increase in investment about 60%. The president recognized that. President Barack Obama has set a vision for the future. He wants us to add high-speed rail to our network, but he also called for investing at $550 billion. That's about the scale of what we had recommended. I represent the 50 states, and we, about 3 years ago, came up with a similar recommendation. We were thrilled. The president has set the marker. This is what America needs. Barbara Boxer, your senator, is our champion, and she's doing everything she can in partnership with Max Baucus, the chair of the Finance Committee, to avoid what we see coming right now. If we fail to pass an authorization act for highways and transit, the system will see a one-third reduction, not the increase that the president's called for and Steve's panel called for, but a reduction of about one-third. Senator Baucus are doing everything they can. They had a meeting yesterday. I was in a meeting with her last week where they're trying to find everything possible to sustain investment at current levels at least past the presidential elections. Then let's regroup. Now, if you remember back to the deficit reduction discussion last fall, and you saw the Simpson-Bowles, this Erskine-Bowles for the Democrats and Alan Simpson for the Republicans and a panel of a lot of members of Congress and others, they came to the conclusion that we needed to get the long-term deficit situation in the U.S. under control. We needed a combination of revenue increases and reductions in spending. But part of the package that they put forward was a 15-cent fuel tax increase. Our hope is that we can work with Senator Boxer and a bipartisan coalition in the Senate, find a way to sustain the spending, get us past the presidential election. We'd love a six-year bill, and we'll still work toward that. But for sure, sustain current levels of investment, because the alternative, if we can't do what Senator Boxer is trying to achieve, the default position is a one-third reduction in highway and transit spending, and the loss of 1 million jobs next year. That's if we can't succeed this year, that's what's coming at us at the federal level next year. So that's what we have at stake. We're trying to get past the presidential election. Then we think, Steve, your idea of a sales tax has tremendous potential because it's revenue neutral. There is absolutely no chance, Asha, with all due respect, of getting the Republican Party, whether the House or the Senate, to vote for a tax increase in their near future. But a revenue-neutral measure, such as a conversion to the sales tax, that has some chance, and it has great potential. But let me wrap it up with a discussion of what's happening at the state and local level, because just like we heard from Stephen, Mike, it is not as hopeless in the real world. Washington is a different world, and that happens to be where I work, together with Polly, and I'm looking forward to your remarks. But in the real world, coalitions are being formed, and legislators of both parties are listening, and people are finding ways to solve problems. I was in Atlanta a month ago, and Atlanta and Georgia is going to follow the example set by the California self-help counties. They've divided the state into 12 regions, and next July, a year from this July, they'll give the voters a chance to vote on referenda all over Georgia to determine whether the voters want to support strategic investments in their future in highways and transit. So I was meeting with the Urban Land Institute and the Atlanta Chamber of Commerce, and the business community and community leaders are beginning to formulate which projects to put on the table, how to build support at the community level, and they're hoping to follow California's example. I think we're 18 of your metro counties have generated majorities of 67% or greater, and it's just phenomenal the foundation work that your local governments have done, but then that the voters have delivered. So Georgia's going to follow your example. Kansas, a year ago, found a way to pass a 1 cent sales tax increase and then have transportation share a third of that with education and social services. So it was bipartisan effort and multi-sectoral. It was education, social services, and transportation that jointly got a 1 cent increase through the legislature. Oregon has passed a 6 cent fuel tax increase. The polling showed the same thing that Asha's polls showed. If a politician read those polls and obeyed them, they wouldn't stand a chance. But they had courage and leadership in the legislature, and they passed a 6 cent fuel tax increase, and they let it go 2 years into the future. It passed in 2008 and didn't kick in until this year, but it said it will only kick in when the economy has two quarters of growth, and then it kicked in. Minnesota passed an 8 cent fuel tax increase over the veto. They overrode the veto of Governor Pawlenty, now running for president. So across the country, and then you look at your track record, 77% of the transit measures, such as my friend Sound Transit up in Seattle, $17 billion being invested in that metro system, supported by the taxpayer. So The long-term debate I think we're going to face in the U.S., hopefully we can get past the next couple of years without this draconian cut of 1 million jobs that we'll lose next year. But what I'm anxious to do is see what we can limp through the next couple of years and then reopen the national debate on a bipartisan basis of whether there's any hope out of Washington or whether the only hope remains at the state and local level. I don't think the American people will tolerate us not competing with the Europeans and the Chinese and the Brazilians and the Indians. I think they will insist on us doing what we have to do to move ahead. The real debate that I see coming is whether the leadership is going to come at the federal level or by default have to be picked up by the states and localities.
Thank you, John. Well, we've got an extraordinarily large pile of good questions here, and not a lot of time to deal with them. I'll try and summarize some of them into thematic opportunities for you to comment on, and we'll save the hard ones for Secretary Trottenberg. Let's look first at the specifics of the gas tax. One person asked, and I'm going to answer this one, when was the last time the gas tax was increased and what's happened since? And I think Steve covered some of that, but keep in mind, hasn't been raised since 1991. Its value, or 1993, October 1st. Its value has declined by about 70%. Yeah. It is collected less and less as we drive more efficiently in more efficient vehicles. It's just really almost disappearing. And the fact that we can't do anything with it is very troublesome. But let's talk about what we can do with it. Asha mentioned that those who are most likely to support an increase are also the least likely to vote. There may be some implications there. Steve talked about the sales tax proposal, and I think that is very interesting. Be interested in Asha's reaction to that, but also from Steve, what happens if gas prices go down? We've had that phenomenon before, and also how does a sales tax relate to our desire to have more efficient vehicles? And one sort of broader question, I think John got to it a minute ago, should we just give up on the federal gas tax and let the states take it over? And generally, how do people feel about what Asha was telling us? Is there any hope, and I think John has said it's limited, for where we're going? But let me throw those out for discussion. Asha?
Wow, well, that's a lot to respond to. Is there a particular one you...
Yeah, whichever one you think...
Well, I think the national sales tax idea as a substitute for the per-gallon current gas tax system we have is definitely worthy of consideration. And I can see from a political calculus standpoint, it potentially is nice because if gas prices keep going up, whether it's with inflation or greater gasoline shortages, we would have stable or increasing revenues. One thing I know that has been of concern with the county level sales tax revenue used for transportation is that it's not so easy to predict. Driving varies a bit from year to year, but it's sort of easier to predict into the future how much gas we will be selling, whereas the economy is so volatile. And that, of course, creates problems for long-term planning, especially of large capital projects, since you no longer have as much assurance about how much revenue will be coming in each year. And I don't know the answer to the trade-off. Maybe it's worth making if that's the only way to keep our revenues from continuing to fall. But I think that's something, especially from the people on the panel or in the room who actually have budgets that they have to plan for and meet, might have some interesting comments to give. So maybe I'll just stop there.
Well, I have thought of that one, because look, gas prices, everyone knows, they do this all the time. They change 10 cents over a weekend. So how do you deal with that volatility? And the specific proposal we've made is that you would need some kind of floor and ceiling that you would write into federal law, essentially, so that you would authorize the program to a floor. And that is what you would set in year one when you say revenue neutral, here's the number. Now, what happens if prices fall below the floor? You need, as Asha said, you need a way to ensure predictability. So our proposal would be you have a general fund backstop that makes sure that you don't go below that floor. Now, what happens when gas prices zoom? It seems to me you ought to have a ceiling that would say that up to that ceiling, the transportation program can keep the upside. Perhaps above that ceiling, what you would say is the money would spill back over into the general fund. And the first use of that spillover would be to pay back any loans that we needed to take care of the downside. So there is a provision in federal law called Revenue Aligned Budget Authority, RABA, which basically says that you get the money that the tax, whether it's gas, excise, or sales tax, generates. It seems to me that could be the mechanism that allows the revenue between the floor and the ceiling to be generated for transportation and to use. Above the ceiling, the general fund benefits could help us reduce our deficit. Another, I think, appealing thing about this proposal. Below the floor, you do need some support from the general fund. But over time, again, over years and decades, there's no question in my mind that the price is going to rise. Oil is a finite commodity, and especially, as John says, as China and India industrialize, the price is going to go up, but it's going to go up like this. So I think there is a way to smooth that growth, but I would still prefer that revenue measure, which will grow over time, to one that only goes in one direction, which is to fall.
John, what about, or Mike, what about cutting Washington out of the picture and leaving it to the states?
It doesn't work, Mark.
Yeah.
I wish I wouldn't have to work as hard if I could just do that, but We depend on the federal government for about 40 to 45% of highway and transit capital investment. So it's crucial that it be sustained. It's unlike federal aid to education, which is about 6 or 7%. It's helpful, but in our case, it's absolutely crucial. Some states, you defined 13% here in California because of the aggressive investments and support you've had from your voters and your Proposition 1A or whatever it is that, that added billions and billions to your long-term capital investment. Most states are much more heavily dependent on federal investment than is California or Utah, for example. Alaska, 100% of their capital investment. Montana, Wyoming, the rural states absolutely have to have it. So it's a non-starter. If in South Dakota, for example, if you eliminated the federal program and transferred the tax-raising ability, they'd have to triple their fuel taxes in South Dakota. In our case, it's absolutely crucial. Some states, you defined 13% here in California because of the aggressive investments and support you've had from your voters and your Proposition 1A or whatever it is that, that added billions and billions to your long-term capital investment. Most states are much more heavily dependent on federal investment than is California or Utah, for example. Alaska, 100% of their capital investment. Montana, Wyoming, the rural states absolutely have to have it. So it's a non-starter. If in South Dakota, for example, if you eliminated the federal program and transferred the tax-raising ability, they'd have to triple their fuel taxes in South Dakota to hold their own. So it's a non-starter, but more the difficulty we're going to face, and let me just end with this political note. Robert Bennett, this last year in Utah, got thrown out of office. He wasn't allowed to go on the ballot because he came in third in a statewide convention. Orrin Hatch is facing a similar dynamic in Utah this coming election. And the difficulty of getting a bipartisan approach in the House and the Senate in Washington right now is that the momentum is of the Tea Party movement is so strong, and the forces that require folks to sign an anti-tax pledge has been there so long, it's going to be very difficult to reverse that in the near term.
Mike?
Yeah, I would just say that I think that while there could be some balance of some portion that would be state or local or regional, and I think there's an absolute pressing need. This is national. It's actually global in scope. We talked about, John, I like you saying the Chinese are playing catch-up. That's not what they're playing at all. They're playing pass-up. And we should be all feeling like those in Great Britain felt back when we started to just do what China is doing now. But our strongest ally, or maybe our strongest case here, is your polling indicates the environment and what we put into the air. Now, environment is a dirty word in some circles, so we may have to relabel it. But I can tell you that the UITP, which is the European version of APTA, they have a goal to double their market share on transit by 2025. And in order to double their market share, given the growth of the population, they're going to have to triple their ridership. Now, that is a bold, audacious goal. And they're doing it out of a sense of stewardship of what they're putting into the environment. And God, compared to what we put into the environment, we really need to get real about what this is. So I think national, we've got to have national policy. We've got to have enlightenment. We've got to have, I think, if you have information and you have knowledge and then understanding and then enlightenment, God prayed that maybe it would lead to courage and conviction.
A 12-step program.
Well, maybe that's five or six of them anyway. I don't know what else.
Infrastructure investment.
I've
got a lot of questions that relate to how we spend the money, and I think the research clearly does, and the experience says if you can make the case it's being spent well, you're at least a little step towards making it happen. But there's several questions, like Steve, to comment on how MTC goes through its planning process. How do you pick the capital projects that are the most beneficial, the most cost-effective? There's a lot of views expressed here that some projects aren't worth doing, others very much needed, ranging from all the money should go to transit to why are we doing high-speed rail. But generally, how do we make the case that we're making the best investments, and not just from Steve, but from others on the panel as well?
Look, I think that question puts its finger on the key issue for me, because we tend to have this revenue debate in the abstract, and we all can throw out billions of dollars in numbers. What the public, I think, what a lot of members of the public remember is, for example, the bridge to nowhere. They remember that. That, in fact, became a metaphor for the federal government. Our program became a metaphor for bad governance, for shady dealing. And we have a long way to go, I'm afraid, in Washington to restore confidence in the federal government. Now, the fact that earmarks constitute 10% or so of the federal program, that most of the decisions are made by state and local officials, that most of those decisions are supported by the public, and in fact the public in California here, they not only support the decisions, they make the decisions, because so much of our money is generated by plebiscite, and it's a revenue measure with a set of projects, and you're given a transaction, and do you support the transaction or not? I think that, frankly, is why we have been so successful in California, because one of the things we can tell people when they vote on a local measure or a state measure is it's not going to Washington. And that's not the selling point we want to have. We need to restore confidence, I think, in the federal program. We need to give it a mission. When we were building the interstate system, everyone knew what the job was. There was no question about it. I think the fact that the bridge to nowhere bubbled up the way it did speaks to the fact that the federal program has lost its sense of mission. And I agree with Mike. It is not a mission that we can have 50 states undertake or 20 cities undertake. This is a mission for the nation. The commission I served on set out specific goals and objectives that we thought we needed to meet, like let's reduce highway fatalities by 50% in 10 years. We can do it. I mean, we're doing it now in part because we're not driving as much, because no one has a job, but we could do it for real. There is so much this country can do, and I think some of us up here are running the risk of getting a little misty-eyed because we have seen what our country can rise to do, not just in this field, but in so many fields of endeavor. And what we're really missing is the will.
Oftentimes, and for many years, I mean, since John Horsley's been at AASHTO, and which is traditionally been more highway-oriented than transit, you'd agree, right?
Mm-hmm.
And Bill Millar's been at APTA, there is more of a realization that we need this. This is like golf. You need every club in the bag. You need balance. You need different people taking different trips. And the truth of it is, you don't need really big shifts from a percentage basis to take what is now gridlock and turn it into free-moving traffic on highways. And all of this, now we have to, you know, I've been along for this great ride for the last 50 to 60 years, where we bought huge, we came back from World War II, gas was plentiful, we built the interstate highway system, the steel workers were working, the concrete workers, construction, we built this thing called a shopping center, we moved out into the suburb, we even have drive-through banks and drive-through wedding chapels and whatever the hell else you name it. It's not sustainable. So it was fun, it was good, we've got to do it smarter in the future. So in order to be sustainable, we got to wake up and then have a balance. We're going to have cars for as long as any of us are going to be alive. I don't. There's your baby's 8 months. Even he.
Good looking kid.
Will still have automobiles, but it's finding that better balance of getting to, you know, where you don't. That's not the choice and only choice, and only club that you use. It'd be like trying to play golf with just a putter.
Several people are asking the question again in terms of balance. Of the balance between public sector investment and private sector investment. What's your reaction to that? Is that a direction we should be moving in? Is there potential for it, or is it something that's ideological?
You know, I think it's both, Mort. I do think there is room for more private sector investment. And it is sort of odd that, you know, here in the land of the free and the home of the brave, we've got a fairly statist approach to transportation investment, whereas in Europe, in Asia, they've got a lot more private money at play. I have to say, though, my experience on this national commission, we had a lot of airtime on this subject. And most of the people that we heard about saying private investment is the answer were people who didn't want any more public investment. And as Mike just got done saying, we need both. It's not a choice of one or the other. And I'll tell you, the big disconnect is when you look at the rehabilitation shortfalls that we have for roads, for public transit, for our airports, for you name it. There aren't a lot of fancy guys from Goldman Sachs who want to pay for that. You know, what they are interested in, what they are good at, is leveraging investment in new infrastructure in fast-growing areas that they can toll, that they can charge fees to. Because private investment is just sort of a fancy way of saying taking out a loan from somebody, and you got to pay back your loans.
Mike, any private sector people beating on your door to?
Actually, the San Mateo County Transit District, I contract out about 75% of my fixed bus route. I contract out all of the paratransit service. The commuter service at Caltrain is provided by private contractor. The simple truth is you need both for the reasons that Steve said. And let's not forget that the reason we have these facilities that we need all these billions to fix is because public ownership came in the first place, particularly on the transit side. I mean, they were in the hands of free enterprise for many, many years before all of a sudden we started investing in highways and changing the modal splits and doing all those things. So in many communities across our country, the public transit would have disappeared from the urban landscape, all but save a few routes that may have been able to turn a profit in heavily congested areas. So, but we need it all going forward.
Thank you, Mike. And I'm afraid we have run out of time for questions. But let's thank our panelists again for their input. I think it's been food for thought for all of us, especially for our visitor from Washington.